My name is Barb Levy, class of 77, and I'm one of the leaders of the First Women of Lafayette Affinity Group. First, some quick housekeeping. Everyone is muted to start to ensure the best listening experience, but please raise your hand if you have a question or feel free to enter on the chat function. Also, change to speaker view in order to always have the speaker highlighted on your screen. This panel is sponsored by the First Women of Lafayette, which includes Lafayette's first female graduates from the classes of 72 to 81. Throughout this year, we have heard so many stories of transformational experiences our first women have had through athletics. Tonight, you will hear some of those stories. I'd like to introduce our moderator for this evening, Director of Athletics, Sherita Freeman. Sherita is in her fourth year as the Director of Athletics at Lafayette College, taking over the leadership reins in February of 2018. In this role, Freeman leads the college's 23 varsity sports programs. When she was hired, Sherita is one of the 54 women athletic directors of the 380 across Division I conferences. Her first 3 years at Lafayette have been highlighted by improved competitiveness and a continuation of strong academic performance. Sherita also launched and garnered campus-wide support for a five-year strategic plan titled Creating a Championship Culture for Lafayette Athletics. She did that in the fall of 2018, which was only 7 months into her first year. Prior to arriving on College Hill, Sherita spent more than 15 years as a senior level administrator at Temple, Penn, and Dartmouth. Thank you, Sherita, for moderating this evening. And we're very excited to have this whole group together.
Thank you, Barbara. And I am very excited to be moderating this panel this evening. So good evening and welcome to our special CLW conference panel on women in athletics. Tonight, we will take a look at the experiences of female coaches and athletes when women's sports were just starting at Lafayette, and how that time compares to the current experiences of women as coaches and athletes. We hope the discussion this evening will be filled with opportunities to reminisce and also moments of inspiration. We have a large panel tonight to share a wide range of experiences. In order to allow the most time for questions and discussion, I'm going to give a brief introduction of each panelist. Our first panelist is Sharon Mitchell Gish. Sharon was hired by Lafayette College in 1971 to develop the Women's Intercollegiate Athletic Program. Initially, Sharon was the only woman in a department of 20 plus full-time men. In the first few years, Sharon coached field hockey and basketball. In 1975, Sharon was given approval to hire additional full-time staff. Barbara Young, who coached several teams, was hired and the number of women's sports offered grew. In 1980, the lacrosse team won the Women's Lacrosse Association's Division II National Championship, which was cause for great celebration. Once the excitement died down, Sharon had the difficult job of notifying the team that she had resigned from her position to marry and move to Northern California, where her husband, Verl Gish, was a dean at Sierra College. Since her time at Lafayette, Sharon has coached field hockey and club lacrosse at UC Davis and enjoyed a 24-year career with the Central Coast YMCA, of which she was president and CEO for the last 12 years. Sharon is currently retired and has a consulting business where she provides executive coaching and consulting services to individuals and nonprofits across the country. Next, we have another beloved female coach, Barbara Young. Barbara was a member of the Lafayette community for 28 years, serving as the head coach of volleyball, basketball, and men's and women's tennis. She coached women's tennis for all 28 years, and her combined men's and women's tennis record was 389 wins, 168 losses, and 2 ties. She was the volleyball coach for 11 seasons and led the team to a school record of 175 wins, while coaching basketball to a 59-26 mark through 5 years. Both Sharon and Barbara coached some of the first female athletes at Lafayette, including our next panelist, Leslie Ann Howard, class of 1976. Leslie majored in psychology and lettered in 3 varsity sports. Leslie swam for the newly formed women's swim team her sophomore year when the coach saw her swimming laps in the old gym, and she joined the women's softball team as it was forming her senior year. Probably one of the most formative events for Leslie at Lafayette was her year managing the varsity men's football team, a first for women in athletics in the country. Leslie served as president and CEO of United Way of Dane County for 26 years in Madison, Wisconsin. She has a son and stepdaughter and lives in Madison with her husband, Rick Stolgaitis. Betsy Houston Fadum, class of 1976, was also one of our first women athletes. She graduated with a degree in economics and was presented with the Charles L. Albert Award, which recognizes the outstanding senior athlete. In Betsy's 4 years at Lafayette, she played 4 years of field hockey, 4 years of basketball, 2 years of lacrosse, and in her senior year was captain or co-captain of all three sports. Additionally, she was named honorable mention to the All Philadelphia hockey team. After college, Betsy worked in the financial services industry for 11 years as a project manager. Betsy, the mother of two sons, currently resides with her husband in Devon, Pennsylvania, and has served as an elected local official for the past 19 years. Our next panelist, Jennifer Stone, class of 2004, is not only an alumna and former student athlete, but is currently Lafayette's head field hockey coach. As a student athlete, Jennifer played 4 years of both field hockey and lacrosse, serving as team captain in her senior year. She earned many accolades and became one of the most successful players in program history. After graduating, Jennifer spent 6 years as an assistant coach with the Leopards before taking the head coach position in 2012. Under her leadership, the field hockey team has been a force in the conference every year. In 2019, Jennifer was named Patriot League Coach of the Year. And finally, we are joined by one of our current student athletes, Jacqueline Fine, class of 2021. Jacqueline, a senior on the women's lacrosse team, represents her fellow student athletes as president of the Student Athlete Advisory Committee. She is majoring in economics with a minor in anthropology and sociology. So what a fantastic group we have this evening. We will start with some questions that I have for our panelists and their experiences, but I also want this panel to be interactive. If you have a question for a panelist or a comment or even a memory, please feel free to share it in the chat or raise your hand. So let's jump in on our discussion. So let's start. Lafayette was founded in 1826, but the first female student athletes arrived on campus in the fall of 1970. It was another 2 years before women's sports became an activity offering for students. So Sharon, we're going to start with you. Can you speak a bit about the coaching experience with the first women's teams? What were some of the challenges and what were you most surprised by? And I'm sure you have some pretty interesting stories to share with us.
Are you able to unmute yourself, Sharon?
I am. I wasn't sure if you were going to unmute me or not. So, coaching the first women at Lafayette was just an absolutely wonderful experience. For me, they were exactly the kind of athletes that any coach would like to coach. They were confident. They were smart. They loved the games. They were willing to do whatever was needed to be successful. And they were real team players. And I think that made the difference when we first started women's sports there, because many of the schools that we played had had teams for a long period of time. And we didn't have any recruitment money. We didn't have any recruitment. We were happy to see the women who showed up on the field. And so they had to really be able to play well as a team. And I've always been a team player from the time I was little, so that made sense to me. I always wanted everybody to get in the sandbox and play nicely. And so I wound up seeing that we had those kind of women. So that made it a lot easier to build the kinds of teams we did. The job also came with really some real challenges. One of the biggest ones was convincing some of the men in the department, in the athletic department, and many of the male alumni that the women were going to bring things to Lafayette that added to Lafayette's stature and its reputation. And not all men had that as a base of thinking about the coeducation. And Title IX was just a big deal then. So a lot of people were very concerned that the women were gonna get, you know, really aggressive and we were gonna take money away from the men and, you know, our programs were. And so part of my job was really good public relationships. You know, I knew that demanding wasn't gonna work, you know. So I went about getting what we needed using some other ways, and we wound up having basically getting a lot of help from the men. The majority of the men in the athletic department were very supportive, And we had some that just stepped up big time right away. Bill Lawson. Aaron, nice to meet you. I'm Bill Lawson, and I'll take the women swimming, you know? And Bill Donahue, taking the track, Art Statham, doing some softball. The other thing is that the women really took care of themselves. They would find a, maybe they liked volleyball, maybe they liked fencing, maybe they liked whatever. And they would go find a professor who had had some experience in that, and they would get a group going, and that helped things move along also.
So Sharon, thank you. And you know, I certainly appreciate you pushing the envelope there. And I'm sure that that Barbara may have some more to
hear
from her perspective in terms of what were some of the challenges and what that experience was like to coach some of the first women here at Lafayette.
Well, I think Sharon really paved the way for me because the teams were established when I began. And Sharon, what one thing was, I coached three sports as the head coach, and then I was Sharon's assistant coach. So I actually had a relationship with several of these women through the just the fact that I was coaching them in all these different sports. But the women were true athletes. They, you know, they weren't, we didn't just recruit them out of the classroom and teach them the fundamentals. They wanted to be competitive. Lafayette was ready to support women's sports. They were competitive. All the teams did really well right from the beginning. And, you know, I was surprised at the level of commitment and the level of ability that they all had.
So my next question is, you know, when you're trying to start teams and you're looking for players, what were you looking for in your players as a coach? And Barbara, we can start with you.
Well, I think definitely the commitment. And I think one of the reasons that Lafayette was so successful is that there was tremendous cohesiveness among the women on campus. When I began, there were just 120 women. And that cohesiveness made it extra special in the classroom, as well as on the field and intramurals and the social life at Lafayette. There was a real bond of the women. So I think that helped tremendously. And, you know, as Sharon said, these were strong women, confident women coming to a men's college. I mean, Lafayette was still in the very early stages of going co-ed when I joined. So it's tremendous to see the growth that women's sports have made at Lafayette. And I really was fortunate to have been a part of it.
Absolutely. And thank you for being the part of our tremendous start. Sharon, would you have anything to add there in terms of what you were looking for, what you were hoping to get or accomplish from the women that you had the opportunity to coach and lead?
Well, there's a little bit of a challenge in there because there was a woman hired in 1970 and she left like in late July. So I was interviewed in late July, early August, offered the job that afternoon, and I was on the job very, very early. So some of the challenges I faced were not about the women. I had to figure out, where are we going to practice? Where do they hide the equipment? Where are the uniforms? How many people, who did they play last year? What's their schedule? I had so little time to prepare, so I had to hit the deck running. So fortunately, my experience was like Barb's. They just showed up and they were ready, and it was just a great group of women. You had to have some confidence in order to go to a school that had been all male for 150 years. And I just brought it, and it was just a great group. It was a very, very special group. We played on March Field, which added to the attraction, because a lot of people enjoyed playing on that field because the fraternities were around it at the time. And the men would sit out on the fraternity porch, put their feet up on the railing and yell and scream during the game, drinking their beers or whatever they were doing. And it made for a fun environment. So that was before Metzger Fields. We didn't go out to Metzger Fields initially. And I do have to give a shout out to a lot of the people that helped us. The grounds crew did a wonderful job of keeping that field so it was playable. You know, field hockey on that field in front of the fraternities after they parked on it on a Saturday for the football game, and they had to get it ready for a Monday afternoon, either practice or game. I mean, the field, the guys really did a great job of that. And at the end of the first year, I did one of the smartest things that I've ever done, is I said a thank you to the head groundskeeper. He said in all his years at Lafayette, he'd never gotten a thank you. And so even now, all the women that are playing on any fields anywhere probably have the best fields, because somebody way back in 1971 wrote a thank you to somebody. But that's what women bring, something different to a campus. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you for sharing that story. And you mentioned the support that you received from Coach Lawson. And I think you both would certainly be able to speak to, you know, during that time when you're trying to get the schedule together, you're trying to figure out where the uniforms are, you're trying to figure out how you're going to operate your teams. I would guess that there were male coaches that were supportive during that time. So can you talk about just in general what kind of support you did receive from the male coaches during that time? But also, you know, were there any unique challenges that you faced or, you know, just, you know, people who were a little skeptical about women coming in and being athletes here at Lafayette?
Yes, there definitely were people who were skeptical. Within my first eight weeks of being on the campus, I was asked to be the guest speaker at an alumni group up in Wyoming Valley. And they were men, and they had decided that they were not going to give to Lafayette anymore because the women were coming. And I didn't know all that background. And it wasn't until we were in the car on the way up to this alumni association meeting that the person from the Lafayette staff shared with me the good news that I was going to get to help. My job that day was supposed to be to gather the men. And I had spent a lot of time thinking about, you know, with the Title IX. So I spoke about how I felt that the women would be attracted to Lafayette. I felt like they would become good alumni. They would generate their own revenue in some cases. They would be able to raise money. They would give money. And maybe they'd had too much drink to drink or whatever, but they kind of smoothed out by the end of the evening, and it seemed to be, and they did not then stop giving. So I must have said a couple of the right things, but I did practice that speech a lot because, you know, and then when I got there and I realized that wasn't what they wanted to hear. I've got this group that I never want to give money. So I was, you know, but it was, the message I gave was give the women a chance. They're going to do a good job. They're going to have good jobs, and they're going to support the college. And we don't need to take things away from the men in order to get it for the women. I can't say enough about the men that I worked with. You know, I was the only woman. You know, I know they were concerned that they might lose something because the women needed some equipment or whatever, but they never showed it to me. They always were supportive of it. As I said, many of them said, what can I do? They would come out and watch our games and support us. A funny story on that one. One of the football coaches came up to me after a basketball game, and he said, you know, I got to see your game yesterday. You know, I said, yeah, it was great. We won. How do you know? He says, yeah, that, I'm not going to say her name. You know, that's Susie Smith. She has great legs. She has great legs. So I'm like, what do I say to this? You know, so it was trying to educate the men in a way that gave them a place to stand. So I said to him, I'm so glad you came to see the game. We really appreciate you men showing up and supporting us. But here's what I'd like to ask you. The next time you see a game and you and I meet in the hall and we're chatting, I'd love for you to talk to me about the zone press that we use that caused us to win the game, as opposed to talking about Susie's legs. So it was a matter of just one person at a time educating them. And I was thrilled to see Barb at the first staff meeting. I mean, there are two of us now. So, it was fun.
That is excellent. And Sharon and Barbara will be with us throughout the evening, but we're going to shift now to our first women athletes. So we're going to turn now to Leslie and Betsy. And I think it would be great to just hear for some of our work, for some of our first women athletes, how they got their start. You know, was their start, you know, in high school? Were they athletes then as well? Or did they get their start here at Lafayette College? So we're going to start with Betsy. Can you share with us, you know, how you got your start in the athletics world, but also too how it came to be here at Lafayette College?
Thank you, Sharita, and what a privilege it is to be here tonight with the two coaches, the only two coaches I had at Lafayette, a classmate in Leslie and our current field hockey coach in Jennifer Stone. So thanks for putting this together. And just to clarify something, you and Sharon were talking about finding the uniforms. I just want to remind everybody that we only had one uniform. We used the same uniform for every sport, I think, for my first 2 years. So I just want to clear that up, that we just passed it on. I played three sports in high school, field hockey, basketball, and lacrosse, and it wasn't unusual as an athlete. You would just move from one season to in the next. I knew no better. I got to Lafayette, ran into Sharon, I think at orientation, walking across the quad. She happened to have gone to college with one of my high school coaches, which I did not know. So I felt like I had a friend already. Showed up the first day on March Field, and I think much to her surprise, we had a considerable amount of athletes just naturally came to Lafayette. So I'd like to think that we didn't know any better. We didn't know we were unique. We just showed up. We didn't know there wasn't really a class before us or after us, and we were just happy to play. So when that season ended, we moved over to basketball. First season, we only had six women on the team, and seven. And we had nobody to scrimmage against, as you can imagine. So we also didn't get the ideal practice time. We were there usually at noon, and we had pickup games with the guys who were there doing intramurals. So that was the way we scrimmaged for our entire first season of freshman basketball. We did get more girls as time went on, and by the time I was a junior, we were recruiting, and then Barb coached me my senior year. Lacrosse was a club sport in my junior year. We didn't have it in freshman and sophomore. And then by the time I was a senior, it was a varsity sport. And that was out on Metzger Field. So that was the first time we traveled out there. So I feel we were just the first or second rung of a ladder. And the coaches, certainly Sharon and the women right before us, really started it. And I know there are about 20 women on this call that could sit in my seat and tell just as many wonderful stories and continue to march us up that ladder. So thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us and for sharing your stories with us. Leslie, let's hear from you in terms of how you got your start here at Lafayette.
Great, thanks. It's great to see everybody. I'm so excited because we've got the class of 76 here. OJ's here, Susie Tischler, Terry DiOrio. So, it's like a little reunion. I love it. And it's making me remember some other things. So, you know, in some ways, my experience was similar to Betsy's once I got into sports, but I did not play sports in high school. I didn't consider myself an athlete, and coming to Lafayette, didn't expect to play athletics. And it really changed my life. I think that, you know, some of my classmates know that I was I was doing my laundry in Roof Hall, and I think it might have been, I don't know. I don't know if OJ was there, but there were some guys there. And there was a sign up that said, manager of the varsity men's football team, you know, and come out for it, and male or female. And I love football. I obviously hadn't played football, but people talked me into it. So I decided to do it. And it ended up being just a tremendous experience, obviously getting into athletics my freshman year, working with the guys. Sharon and Barbara were saying, you know, the coaches, the athletic department was fantastic. Davidson, Ole Koloval, but then Coach Putnam and Stan Johnson, who was the co-manager. And OJ being on the call reminds me of Tony Giglio, who was our star running back and, you know, ran 1,000 yards, I think, my freshman year. He was a senior then. The kinds of things I had to do were, Tony had these old shoes from high school that were his lucky shoes. And the laces had worn down so much, but he had to have those same laces. So like during breaks, I'd be tying these laces for Tony. I mean, the crazy things we had to do, and I was in the locker room. I mean, it was quite an education as a young woman, but I learned how to kind of stand up to the guys in the most male of male environments. It was really a great experience and one that I loved. But then come spring, I was swimming in the old gym, in the old pool, and Coach Lawson was lifeguarding. And I was swimming a mile because I had lifeguarded myself, but was never swam. And he's like, hey, I'm putting a team together. Will you come out? So I decided to leave behind the managing of the football team and instead join the newly forming women's swimming team. We did have swimsuits. So that was one piece of uniform that we did get. But, you know, it was a small team to begin with. And it's the kind of thing that we were on the bus one day going out to a meet in Western Pennsylvania. I can't remember where we were going. And the coach realized that our diver wasn't going to be able to dive that day and realized it was going to be a really close meet. So he was recruiting somebody to dive. And he said, can anybody do three dives? And I knew how to do two. And he's like, I'll teach you how to do a back dive. So I ended up diving, you know. And I guess I tell that story just because it was, you know, we had to be so flexible. And as Barbara and Sharon both were saying, you know, you had to get in there and just do what was needed to kind of fill in the team. And we learned so much that way and created some great bonds. And then in softball, I mean, that was my senior year, and Coach Statham, who was, Terry, do you remember? He called us his screamers. And because there were some people who hadn't played sports, and when the ball would come to them, they would scream. But that was only in the beginning of the season. We really toughed it out and had to figure out what positions we were playing. He taught me how to pitch because we didn't have enough pitchers. I will say Terry Diorio was very skilled at catching. So she covered for me many, many times. Thank you, Terry. But it was a great experience. And just, I'm so grateful, and thank you for inviting me to be able to, you know, tell these stories if anybody's interested, because it's fun reliving them.
Well, thank you for being here and thank you for sharing. Betsy mentioned in her opening remarks that, you know, she didn't really realize that, you know, you were a pioneer. From my perspective, I consider you both to be pioneers for women, and certainly for women athletes here at Lafayette College. Did you feel like you were a pioneer? Was that something you understood in that moment while you were here?
Well, if you're asking me, Sharita?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the football deal, I saw that I was going to be a woman doing it, but it hadn't occurred to me that maybe a woman hadn't done that before. And the athletic department kind of made a big deal out of it. It wasn't something I was not looking for, that kind of attention. And it was in all the papers. And during halftime, the other managers would come over and give me, you know, I remember at Rutgers, they'd give me things and t-shirts and whatnot. That made me a little uncomfortable, but, you know, it did cause me to reflect on the fact that we were going co-ed and the responsibility of stepping into those opportunities. So I didn't do it for that reason, but it was hitting me that's what we were all doing, all the women at Lafayette, and the stepping in, as someone said, with maybe some courage or maybe some just, you know, maybe we were crazy. I don't know, but we just decided to roll with it.
A little bit of a combination of both, for sure. I bet in that regard. Betsy, we're going to turn back to you and talk a little bit about your relationships that you developed with your teammates while you're here, which I'm sure you had outstanding teammates. Have you kept in touch with your fellow Lafayette Pards that you met through participating in sports during that time?
Absolutely. And while we have all scattered, we're always a team. And that just is instilled with you. You can run into somebody and pick up right where you left off. There was great camaraderie. It was the women that, the only women we really knew. It was like our sorority. And the benefit also was I got to meet younger classmen and older. And I would not have had that experience, because every year the younger ones would come out and we would get to meet them and know them our years there. As I said before, I've reflected before, Sharon was like a mom for us, even though she wasn't old enough to be our mom, but she was one of our female mentors that we had on campus. And that was a great comfort. And then when Barb came, because there weren't that many faculty, I think they're very fortunate, Sharita, to have you at the helm now. I mean, what a remarkable journey it has been from 50 years ago. So yes, I'm still very much in touch. One of my classmates who played is the godmother of one of my sons. I mean, you don't get much closer than that.
That is fantastic. And Leslie, I'm sure you have some stories or some comments about the relationships that you formed and maintained over the years as well.
Yes, definitely. I actually, Stan Johnson and I, who was the co-manager at the time, have caught up recently to reflect on that. And one of the stories there was we only had two jerseys and it was 36, and he kept the white jersey. He gave me his maroon jersey. And then probably everyone remembers that Fiji burned, you know, that year, the year he was a senior. There was a fire and he lost his jersey. So I gave him my jersey. I gave him his jersey back. And we were talking about, like, do you still have that? I mean, we should be sharing that, cut it in half or something, but great memories.
So Sharita, I just want to add one thing, if you don't mind. I've been reflecting on what was it that got the attention when we came as women? And as I reflect on Leslie's experience being written up in the New York papers of being a female manager on the football team, and our Powder Puff football team, I think got great press. It was really interesting that back in the time, no discount to Lafayette or anyone else, that's what was celebrated, women doing men things. So I think it took a while for us to kind of get our footing and get recognized as athletes and the success of the program, which was always a winning season, as Sharon has pointed out. So it was just an interesting time.
Let's talk a little bit about, go ahead, Leslie.
Well, I was just going to say that, you know, one of the things that I was thinking about is just what it took to allow us to be able to play, and thinking about the young athletes now, and I know we're going to hear from some in a few minutes, but just to be thinking about, Sharita, from your point of view, what are some of the things that Lafayette and the young women athletes need today that, you know, it was such a surprise and a delight to me to have that experience, and I'd like to think about how we as alumni can think about supporting and surprising and delighting the young athletes who are coming in today.
Yeah, and I think that's a great question in terms of the legacy that I'm sure that you and others hope to leave here. And when I think about our women's athletics program, you know, I align that certainly with the goals of the department in general, which is, you know, to create a championship culture, to create this environment of a positive student athlete experience. But I think the perspectives and the experiences of our women athletes, we do need to focus on that. Because it is a place where I think that we can have a tremendous amount of success. So when we think about supporting our women's athletics programs, the first thing that comes to mind is that, you know, scholarship support is certainly important. And I think our coaches would speak to the fact that acquiring talent and being able to offer scholarship dollars is certainly an important part of that equation, especially in, you know, in the age that we are right now in terms of being able to support our student athletes from a scholarship perspective. So the Leopards Champions Fund is one that I think creates an excellent foundation, but, you know, for what we are trying to accomplish, we are looking to do so much more in terms of being able to continue to recruit the best and the brightest. And then some of the other things that we talk about in general is just all of the different support functions that, you know, make for a better experience in terms of developing our student athletes. So whether that's, you know, a nutritionist, a sports psychologist, leadership, career development, all of those things factor into the experience. But, you know, as a former student athlete myself, those are the characteristics and the skills and what athletics brings to girls in sport, to women in sport, that allow them to have the success in their careers in the future. And so anything that we can do to support their experience while they're here are areas that we certainly would need or would like to have additional support, especially for our women that are participating in athletics. So thank you for asking that question. I was going to ask a question about how your coaches helped to prepare you for the games that you were playing and to prepare you for this experience that was the first women athletes here. I don't know if there's any additional context or stories that you would add to your coaches specifically, and maybe some of the things that they've said or things that they did that stuck out in your mind that helped prepare you for the competition or the fact that you were the first while you were here. And Leslie or Beth.
I'll jump in. You know, our memories fade. I think it was the motivation. I echo Sharon's comment about teamwork. We had no trainer. We didn't come back early. We didn't go on any spring trips. We didn't do much. We didn't have a nutrition table. She just motivated. We just became a family. It was just comforting to see each other and to know each other and get to know each other and do something collectively. So certainly she had us run. We certainly didn't like suicides in basketball. I'll really date myself. But it was just the whole experience. It just didn't stop. We just moved from one sport to the other. Some women played multiple sports. I feel extremely blessed that in this day and age, I could not have ever done three, let alone maybe even one. But to be able to do three sports and have that experience and meet the diversity of the women that played, I just couldn't be more grateful.
Well, and I've seen many, if I can add to that, some in the chat about Coach Bill Lawson and just what an impact he had on all of us who swam for him, both men and women. He actually brought us along, the women, to the Swimming Hall of Fame so we could practice in one January or at winter break. And while we were practicing, it was really crowded, and somebody that was butterflying smashed me in the eye, you know, with, we had our goggles on, and I felt like my eye was coming out of my head, and I started to cry, which I didn't really very often. I got out of the pool to say, oh, my eye hurts, and he's like, compose yourself and get back in the pool. I never forgot that, and it was like, and he was a very empathetic guy, but it's like, okay, it's keep going. And then on the football thing, I mean, I was like a chicken with my head cut off sometimes, and I was filming at practice with Stan Johnson. Again, we were up on some scaffolding tied to, in a very windy out at, I forget the name of the field out there. Anyway, where the guys practiced, and we were up videotaping, and it didn't occur to me that we were also, you know, taping our voices. So I was talking to Stan about my boyfriend and problems I was having and whatnot. So the next day when the coaches were listening and watching the tape from practice, they were also listening to my stories. And as we were coming into practice, as they passed me, like, how's your boyfriend doing? How are you doing? How are things going with your boyfriend? I realized like I was completely outed in terms of my personal life, but I lived through it.
You certainly did. So we're going to shift. For those that are on, please continue to think about your questions for Leslie and Betsy, as well as Sharon and Barbara. We're going to shift to Jennifer Stone, who can offer us various perspectives, certainly as a student athlete, but also as a coach in the present day. So Jennifer, we're gonna start with our first question. What are you most proud of from your experience as a student athlete? And how about as a coach?
Yeah, thank you. And I would be remiss first, thank you so much to all the amazing women on this call who have certainly helped pave a path literally for the seat that I'm sitting in. So a big thank you to all of you for making this a possibility. So I do feel as though I'm a bit unique in terms of the position on this call, because I was fortunate enough myself to be a dual sport athlete here at Lafayette, playing field hockey and lacrosse. And I think was probably the point in time where tables started to shift. So from, you know, from my own experience in terms of being a student athlete at Lafayette, I will say I am grateful for the championships. I was fortunate enough to be successful in two sports, winning Patriot League titles and advancing to the NCAA tournament in both field hockey and lacrosse. And takes a lot of work to get there. Certainly know that from the coaching side. And similar to, you know, Betsy talked about it a little bit earlier in the call, but genuinely, you know, I especially sitting now in my chair as the head field hockey coach, I have a tremendous amount of gratitude to be able to say that I did play two sports. It's a different time now. And I say that in a very, very good way. You know, there is a lot of There's a lot of opportunity. There's a lot of experience for young women, and whether that is student athletes who right now have access to sport when they're, you know, 5, 6, 7, 3, 4, 5 years old. But equally, you know, within the athletic department, there's a lot of opportunity for women, whether that is being a student athlete or being a coach or being an administrator to that extent. So I have a great amount of gratitude and wonderful memories being successful as a student athlete here at Lafayette. And honestly, liked it so much that had a bit of a change in career path myself, but was able to come back and coach here at Lafayette at my alma mater, which is fantastic. You know, in terms of being a coach, you know, greatest highlights, the wins and the losses, they come. It's part of sport. And of course, you're going to remember a couple of those games, a couple of the goals, a lot of the goals against, but you're going to remember certain games and championships, no doubt. But I think a bit more holistically, coaching is wonderful. You know, to be able to watch growth and development of players, not only over a 4-year time, but even now to see what they do as alums, young alums, established alums. But I believe that sport is such a wonderful model to enhance women, enhance young women. And I believe we have some of the top leaders on campus, just amazing examples of some driven, hardworking, intelligent women. So I have the benefit of sort of experiencing it day to day, and I don't take any of those days for granted.
Thank you for that. And Jennifer is definitely right that her student athletes are tremendous leaders on our campus. And I certainly appreciate her efforts and her leadership for putting them in the position to do that. But talk a little bit about the challenges of being a coach and maybe share, you know, some of your perspectives about what is it like, you know, coaching student athletes in 2021 in your experience?
Yeah. I guess I would say a little bit in jest, but a little bit in jest, a lot of it in truth, fundraising. You know, it's probably the biggest challenge. But I do say that with a little bit of a joke and a smile, because it is a fantastic way to stay engaged. I love staying engaged with alums. I love hearing about the history that happened before me, and being so connected to players and alums within the program that are beyond just the 4 years time. So I say that a little bit as a joke, but you know, coaching, especially for coaching a millennial, you wear a lot of hats as a coach. And whether that is, you know, it's an easy day if all you're talking about is hockey or basketball or lacrosse. You are a coach, you're a psychologist, you're a CEO, you're a mentor, you're a therapist, you're a manager, you're a mother, there's just oftentimes a lot of balls in the air that you're juggling. And realistically, that is life a little bit. But you have to be, I think, you know, be really present, but at the same time, really making sure that you're developing the players, you're developing the program, you're developing the future, you're developing your staff, you're developing yourself. So I think with that, there certainly are challenges, because you're trying to keep a lot of balls in the air juggling, like I said before. But at the very same regard, that's one of the aspects to coaching that I just love. You know, every day is a new day, and there's always something new, and something pops up, and it's never slow. So that part I actually really do enjoy.
So as you talk about all the different balls in the air, you know, for you as a coach, in terms of your perspective, how do you think the experience has shifted for female student athletes? So, you know, what is that difference between even when Betsy and Leslie were playing, or even to when you were playing, to our student athletes today? We'll hear from Jacqueline in a moment, but from your perspective as someone who's coaching them, how has that changed over the years?
Yeah, I'll kind of quote Betsy again, before Betsy made a comment about marching us up that ladder. And I genuinely echo that. I do believe as though we're marching up that ladder hand in hand with men, to be completely honest with you. That's how I feel. And I am incredibly grateful to know that not every female coach, not every female athlete probably feels that way. Where we sit here at Lafayette, you know, certainly, you know, Sharita being the athletic director and President Allison Byerly as a female and our vice president and Annette Diorio, there is a lot of female leadership, which certainly I think allows coaches, allows females and female student athletes to see that. You see females in leadership position. And I think really that does say a lot. It sends a very powerful message. Now, you know, in terms of some of the obvious differences, athletic scholarships is a really big one. You know, so for the past several years now, the athletic department and certain programs within the athletic department have had access to athletic scholarships. And Sharita, I would completely agree what you said before about the Champions Fund. Recruiting talent is really, really necessary to win championships. So having athletic scholarships allows us as a department to stay incredibly competitive with our peers to attract talent. You know, once a student athlete gets on Lafayette, I always say it, on Lafayette's campus, the school really does sell itself. But the ability to recruit really, really high level athletes who are good in their sport, the ability to offer athletic scholarships really is a game changer. So I think that probably is one of the biggest pieces, but you know, between, 50 years ago to now, there's a lot of progression, but it is a very exciting time in that regard, especially for the female student athletes.
Thank you, Jennifer. And we are going to now turn to Jacqueline, who can offer some perspectives as being a current student athlete. So maybe Jacqueline, you can share with us, you know, how did you first get involved in athletics? And I'm sure, you know, folks would be excited to learn how that may compare to some of the stories we've heard already. And maybe share, you know, a bit about some of the other sports you played as well as lacrosse growing up.
Sure. So first of all, I just want to say thank you, like everyone else. I'm going to double down. This is amazing to hear all the stories, especially being in a position of being a current student athlete. And I don't think I would ever play on March Field ever. So it's very interesting to hear that that was where practice used to take place. So athletics for me was always a part of my family. I grew up in a very athletic family. My dad is actually a football coach. My uncle's a basketball coach. My aunt plays professional soccer. So I was always in sports. And because my dad was a football coach, we moved around a lot. So sports were my outlet. And that's like how I made friends a lot of the time. So I would join any sports team that was available in the new town that was where I moved. So I played soccer, basketball, lacrosse, field hockey. Some I was not so good at and some I was better at. I was not a field hockey player. Jennifer, I would kick the ball, so not good. I was also not the best soccer player. My aunt was pretty disappointed, but I really started to stick to basketball and lacrosse and I loved them. I just loved the community I felt when I was there. I loved the friends I made. I always felt like it was like a little family that I had away from home. And it was like the only stagnant thing that I had as I was moving around. So that's kind of how I got into athletics.
That's excellent. And certainly you are a pretty darn good lacrosse player. So you're here representing us. What does it mean to be a Division I student athlete in the present day?
Oh, that's a great question. I would say being a D1 athlete definitely has its challenges. First and foremost, you are a student. I think that coming to an institution like Lafayette, it's very elite. And you really have to be able to balance a difficult sports schedule with a difficult class schedule. So I would say coming to Lafayette in a D1 program, it was really difficult at first to figure out the balance between academics, athletics, and kind of the rigorous nature of all of it at the same time versus high school. I think in high school, you have more room to make mistakes. But as soon as you come to college, everybody's on the same level as you. And that's what I think is different from D1 athletics today and maybe 50 years ago. I think that because the recruiting process is so competitive and so there's so many people involved, that it can be very difficult to come to a D1 program and say, man, everybody here's pretty good. Like, how am I gonna, you know, work through practice, work through games, and become the best version of myself?
How do you feel the first female athletes, and you certainly heard from two of them today, have paved the way for your current experience?
Definitely. Without them, I wouldn't be here. I genuinely believe that. So I really thank them for all that they had to endure and all that they had to go through in order for me to be here. But the one thing that I would say that I had in common with them is, you know, I developed a family here. As soon as I came to Lafayette, you know, those girls on my team, they're my family. I would do almost anything for them. And that is something that I think that women, you know, that we all come together and create. We create a family, we create a sisterhood, a bond. And I think that because of their, you know, their challenges, all that they had to endure, the bond has just become greater and greater as the years have gone on.
So Jacqueline, I'm just impressed by you when I understand all the things that you're doing on campus and still being an outstanding student and athlete. But can you talk about your experience in terms of being a leader within our department? You're serving on committees for us. You're also the president of SAC. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about, you know, your experience and why you're just so motivated to do all these things and have the impact on our Lafayette community?
Sure. So as Shreya said, I'm the president of the Student Athlete Advisory Committee. So I basically represent Lafayette in the Patriot League and also in the NCAA as the student athlete liaison between the athletic department here and also the athletic department in the Patriot League. So what we try to aim to do is promote a really great communication line between admin and student athletes to really enhance the overall student athlete experience. We really want to create a vehicle for student athlete representation on campus to promote a positive student athlete experience as much as possible. And for me, being in these positions was extremely important. I think that I had a really great perspective because I did grow up on the Hill. I went to high school in Easton, and I really just had always had a passion to come to Lafayette and be a part of this community. And in any way that I could, I wanted to use my voice. Sarita, thank you so much for saying, like, I'm an impactful person, because that's really my main goal. And now I hope to leave an impact on those after me to, you know, take my role and continue to do great work that we've been doing. You know, we've started mental health campaigns, which I think is a big thing right now, especially during COVID. We've also had great guest speakers about diversity and inclusion come to campus. So we're just really trying to make this community as best as it can be.
That is fantastic. And certainly I mean every word that I've said in terms of the impact that you're having on our department. My last question, and again, I know it's not always, you know, that everything is perfect, right? But can you talk about some of the challenges that are faced by our student athletes today?
Sure. I think the biggest one, without telling, you know, we're all on Zoom right now, we're not in person. The COVID pandemic has definitely been probably one of the biggest challenges. You know, I look back and I'm like, man, those sprints were nothing compared to COVID. Run tests, nothing. So I really genuinely think the emphasis on mental health that we have tried to create here at Lafayette has been a really, really huge challenge that student athletes have faced today. You know, one of the things that I really have taken away from this journey of like mental health and learning about it and how to help people is you don't have to be sick to get better. And I think at a lot of times athletes are told to put on a face and to, you know, get back in the game, you know, do your job in the classroom, socially, emotionally, mentally, everything. And it can be a lot to handle. So I think that the pandemic has really taught us, you know, to be with ourselves and to learn a lot more about ourselves. But in doing that, it really, I think it takes reflection on your mental health and making sure that that's okay. So I encourage like any alumni to maybe look into mental health help. I know that that can be really difficult. Having Julia Motto here as a sports psychologist has been extremely beneficial. I know a lot of student athletes that we've heard from SAC have said she's amazing and she really, really helps. So I would say mental health has been a huge, huge emphasis and challenge that we're really trying to face.
For sure. And I think Dr. Julia Motto has done a fantastic job. We probably need probably another two or three of her.
Yes.
she definitely does a fantastic job in her role. I know we're coming up on the top of the hour here. I don't know if there are any questions from the audience or additional questions from the audience. I've been trying to monitor the chat as much as possible. But if anyone has a question that they'd like to ask on camera, feel free to raise your hand and I think we'll be able to navigate calling on you at this moment. Any questions?
Sharita, it's Jennifer. I can't raise my hand, but I was just going to say, do we have any male athletes on the call who could share a little bit about their experience from this time as well?
I think we have OJ, so I don't know if he's got his hand raised, so I don't know his perspective he wanted to offer there, or if there are any male student athletes who wanted to offer comments to Jennifer's question as well.
Well, I was a bench warmer, so if there's somebody else that wants to jump in with that, but I just want to say, first of all, I'm honored to be on this call. It's so great to see my classmates. I'm so proud of them. I remember, you know, Betsy used to write for the school paper when I was the sports editor, would write a lot of the stories about the women's teams. And again, the watching the games at March Field, where the entire field would be lined up with people circulating it. And I remember Leslie running up and down the football sideline with her football jersey on. I can still picture that. I remember being the PA announcer for the Powder Puff football game when I made one of my greatest misspeaks of all time. And I said, here come the Lafayette Leopards. But we won. We beat Lehigh because we didn't beat Lehigh in men's football all 4 years, but we did beat them in the Powder Puff game. But one thing that occurred to me, I can't recall, and maybe Sharon or Barb can answer this, is there was no Patriot League, of course. The men, the first 2 years were in the Mid-Atlantic Conference, and then the second 2 years were in the East Coast Conference. I don't even know if the women were in a league.
We were in the AIAW, Association of Intercollegiate Athletics for Women.
That was the national organization. They had women. That, I mean, was there a regional conference?
No.
I didn't think so. So, you know, that's something that was missing too. But I also think, knowing how many people played multiple sports, that was wonderful. And obviously those days are gone. But again, I just want to say it's a privilege to be on this call with, and congratulations to all of you.
Thank you for sharing that, Tom.
Sharita, I saw one other hand raised. I think the name is McDonnell. Can you unmute yourself? Or Dana, are you able to unmute them?
Let's see if we can.
I'm not seeing another raised hand.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. They're raising their physical hand.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I was looking for the little yellow symbol.
Can you raise your hand again just so that she can see where you are?
Oh, there we go. There we go. Okay.
And then are you able,
are you able to unmute now?
On your screen? Oh, yeah, unmuted for a second there.
There we go.
There we go.
Hi, I just wanted to say thanks to everyone for this opportunity to take a walk down memory lane. A lot of interesting names, old friends came up. My name is Professor Ed McDonald, Professor Emeritus. I served on the faculty of Lafayette College for 50 years plus. And in the early 70s, Bill Lawson was swamped as swimming coach, lacrosse coach, and Provost Sauce called me into his office. And he said, I saw you playing tennis down at Sullivan Lane, and we need an interim tennis coach. Would you agree to do this? I said, well, I'm busy. I was teaching Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, and doing some graduate work at Columbia University. At any rate, he told me, he said, no faculty committees. How about that? I said, okay. I was very interested in listening to the veritable challenges that the other coaches experienced. I really had none of these. All of the players who came to me, and I didn't have to do any recruiting, they were all there, were student athletes in the best sense. And I had really nothing contentious during that year, except maybe Oli Kolovol and I maybe did not share the same view that active and meaningful participation in a team trumped wins. She was always talking to me about wins. And I said, well, Oli, I really think that these guys are participating and they're doing a great job. And I too experienced that sense of community and group solidarity, especially when I took them on a trip south through Delaware, Virginia, and into the Carolinas. I never could have experienced this within a classroom setting. And as a matter of fact, it was only a short year, but like Betsy Houston, one of the team members became a godfather of my son. And I just wanted to thank everybody for this walk down memory lane. Thank you very much.
And thank you. And I think at this moment, first, I want to thank all of the panelists, but to close us out, I'd like to turn it over to Sue for some final comments.
Thanks, Sharita. You did just an amazing job. So, I think we all have huge smiles on our faces, maybe a tear in our eye as we walk down memory lane here. So thank you so much.
I can't believe it's March already. Been planning this 50th year celebration for such a long time. We had, you know, our first major Zoom event in September, and then we had another one in January, and then this one tonight. And you know, when you plan something, you have a vision of how it's going to happen. And this really exceeded our vision for sure. So big smiles. And it was so much fun. I wasn't an athlete, but I was a groupie hanging around watching. So I enjoyed it as much as anybody. So as Sharon said, she knew the women would give as much as the men. And so I'd like to put in my never-ending plea for the first women of Lafayette Scholarship Fund. Don't forget it. Give like a girl, give like a part in pearls, whatever you want to say. And we're doing great work. We had a great successful night last week, I guess it was. what do we raise over $100,000? So we're on a roll. Let's keep it going. And maybe we can celebrate the 50th year of co-education every year from now on so we can keep programs like this going. But anyway, it's great to see everybody. OJ, hey, all my classmates that are on, and everybody at the college, and all the coaches emerita. So thank you.